Welcome, Music Multiverse listeners. Welcome to Beyond Your Radio's You Should Listen To. I'm your host and creator, Mark Kuligowski. We're always thinking about, well, how we can strengthen our connection to bringing you new music. Now remember, new music doesn't mean it's new. It's new to you. So when we break out an album and you go and you watch the channel and you're a music aficionado like me, crock of crap. But if you hear an album and you're like, I know that album, okay, but it might be new to that person who's 16, who's bopping along to Drake and goes, wait a minute, I don't want to be listening to this. I want to change it up. I want to hear Jimi Hendrix. Who's Jimi Hendrix? I don't know who he is. Those kind of things. So it's new to the person. So, you know, that's take that under advisement. You might not have time to explore. So we do it for you. Tonight, our show centers around Beyond Your Radio's panelists bringing you an album that, you know, that might be in your music happy place. It might be way outside of it. Doesn't matter. But playing a little snippet of it might pique your audio curiosity. All of our panelists have an album to share for one reason or another. So let's find out what they think you should listen to. On the panel tonight, well, the woman who could have had an entire year off if she would have never spent countless hours waiting for me in the record store, Susie Q.
Hi, Sue.
Our resident hard rock metal panelist from the lovely state of Florida where it's some sort of crazy rain and thunderstorm, so he might freeze on us today. We don't know.
Rain.
Mr. Jeff Young. We've got, the woman down the street who just, she's got all the candles lit. There's apparently there's going to be some secret rendezvous afterwards. Damn, is on the program. At least that's what it looks like. I don't know if you guys.
I know.
You know, she's in the red light district. We had no idea.
Hi.
How is everybody tonight?
Great. How are you, sir?
All right.
Yeah. So when I go to do these things, obviously I've got 17,000 CDs behind me and I go, oh, what about that one? Oh, what about that one? What about that one? What about that one? So I just picked mine 37 seconds ago and I'm not happy. I want to change it again, but I'll do it again. Who knows? So let's start out with the man who might be the Jay Giles band. He might freeze frame. Let's start with Jeff Young with his pick for tonight.
So what I picked is an album. So if anybody likes Slipknot, Deftones, Korn, still very popular, this band was one of their influences. And so I picked an album, the second album from Helmet, which is called Meantime. And from 1992, it's our second studio album. It's their most successful album. But it has really some heavy pounding drums that are very clear, like you would actually hear in Slipknot. It's got really memorable like riffs or different rhythm guitar, you know, kind of like when you hear an AC/DC song, you know it's AC/DC. Think of like if their chords were just shorter but still really loud. And when you anybody who is has listened to Helmet, when you hear them, you know who Helmet is. They just have their own sound, even though a lot of people have kind of done what they've done as they have influenced them. But you know, they got some songs on the vocals are very strong, like many metal bands have. It's almost like talking / yelling again. Very much similar to like Slipknot, but but it's done in a way that is fairly clear too. You can understand it.
Keep it down. Best time. I still ignore. I try to hide.
but they also have more softer vocals on some of the songs too. Not as soft as, say, Dave Grohl, but if you could picture like a Dave Grohl and they just had a lot more heavy, more volume on the backing music, that's what this would be kind of like. More pronounced music, I guess, more pronounced or heavier music. Mm-hmm. And for me, like I said, the guitar and the drums are just on their own. Like, I could just listen to the guitar and drums, like, on their own, like, for a whole car ride. It's just so good. And it's, the thing is, I remember when it first came out, like, well, this seems very simple. It doesn't seem, like, very complicated. It's not like five guitar solos from, like, Iron Maiden. But I'm like, but actually, no one's doing this, and they're doing it great. You know, they had achieved like some moderate initial success. I was reading, in fact, they were in a bidding war after their first album. Some of these different, like three different record companies wanted them. They thought they were going to be the quote next Nirvana, but they actually had interest from the record companies before Nirvana even became Nirvana. So they said that was lucky for them, obviously, because they weren't going to be the next Nirvana. But, you know, it doesn't have any, like, there's no lyrics, or none of the songs really have any pop appeal. Although Unsung is one that receives some radio airplay. It's the most popular song. The album cover actually comes in two colors, red and blue, if you need to know that. And then it has been actually called a couple times where I've read different articles and reviews that, you know, it's probably one of the most influential and overlooked albums of the 90s. And I think with this band, they started coining the phrase alternative metal, whereas usually they were two separate genres. But it's a really good album. I mean, it's just, if you like those types of bands, this is kind of like the start of it, and it's just really solid.
Cool.
Yeah. The great thing about alternative metal, right? I would agree with you that was probably in the beginnings, right? There's not too many bands that were doing what they were doing. I was trying to see who produced this, but I think they did. I didn't see anybody on there, but the print is so small, or I'm old, probably both. But 1992. We should have a show called 1992, because we could probably spend an entire year talking about every great album from 1992.
Mm-hmm.
Tons of fantastic records. And that's why something like this gets overlooked.
Yeah.
That's a great pick. And our heavy guy comes through big time. There are just this album pounds. I mean, just the drummer, I afterwards must have been exhausted. And just said, "Are we gonna tour?" And the drummer went, "Can you get somebody else? I'm done. I get a robot. Get somebody, because this is all right. Let's see what Dam has."
Hello, everybody. This album that I chose, the artist is not going to be a stranger to most anybody, and probably the album itself, everybody has heard of it, but if it's younger people, they may not have listened to it. I chose this because there's becoming, and has in the past few years, a real push towards more Latin sound, Spanish sound. Everybody's speaking Spanish, you know, it's just becoming more inclusive in our culture. This album is from 1999. It's their 18th studio album. It's Santana's Supernatural. Mm-hmm. I've been listening to this again. I was in the car, and one of the songs, Maria Maria, came on, and I mm-hmm. got to work, and I decided to listen to the whole album. And it's interesting. I mean, it was number one in 11 mm-hmm. countries. Went platinum 15 times, 9 Grammys that broke the record of Thriller. So there's something to be said about that. The album cover is really cool. And I know that Mark likes to look at album covers. And I think that, you know, it's very Latin, and it's supernatural, and it incorporates a lot of things that the Latin culture thinks of as far as what is supernatural. It was produced by Clive Davis and Lauryn Hill. And this album featured a lot of other artists, Eric Clapton, Dave Matthews, CeeLo Green, I think, and Lauryn Hill played, sang on a song. Watch the master plan, pack the spans on the streets, flip the beat, move the sheep like the shepherd. It's a new day, my crew stay forever striving. Give thanks to be alive and been through the gutter, now we see the horizon. It's clear to me now, used to be confused, took a lot of years to see how. Now we move and plan it, take the average mind and expand it. Take and of course, Rob Thomas, I think that's one of the most famous songs off the album, was Smooth. Now, with all these featured artists, though, there was some criticism that there wasn't consistency in the vocals because there were so many other artists and you weren't just hearing the classic Santana vocal sound. But to me, Santana has always been the guitar that binds their music for me. It's very distinctive. I always know it's Santana. I like having these other people give their feel. And I think that there was an intentional reason to do this because I'm sure Santana's fan base was, unless you were really into guitars or nostalgia, new people were just thinking of them as a Latin Spanish band. And by bringing these other artists on, I think that just kind of rejuvenated them and got a different generation listening to them. So I really like this album. It never gets old for me. I think it's timeless.
Good point that it's timeless. Another good thing that comes with this is the fact that here's a guy who started he's an electric guitarist, right? He's a progressive rock electric guitarist in the progressive nature of moving things forward. Yet his band is more fusion, you know, in that realm, or always hinted at that or came around to that. This is the album that is probably considered for Santana people of the 70s, late 60s too, right?
Yeah,
late 60s. That they would be pissed about because it's pop, you know, and it's a new audience is getting onto it, but technically, he just did what he wanted to do, and everybody else, he's a legend. Everybody wants to play with him. You know, look at it, right? Even back in the day, you know, so he gets the chance to do that. And it's not like he went and picked the people that were crushing it at the time. It just happened to be the people that, I mean, Lauryn Hill was basically, I think at that point, nearly forgotten at that point, I think. I think she was... I think she wanted to be. I don't know. She hasn't done anything that I'm aware of, a singer songwriter wise. But you know, Rob Thomas might have been slightly popular because of Matchbox 20. But
I don't think there was like one of their bigger albums around that time. I think it was almost like, oh, there's Rob Thomas again. Where has he been? That's how I felt when I heard that song. You know, I didn't feel like, oh, there's Rob Thomas again. There he is.
And he didn't load it up. It's not all. His band is still in there. His type of stuff is going still.
Yeah.
He didn't sell out in any way, shape, or form. There's no drum track. There's no,
it's all
live stuff that could be put right on stage and you can get somebody else to sing. It would still be as groovy and hooky as it needed to be in the fusion realm of things. So great record. We've talked about that one from one of the years. I forget what year that was from. What year?
Well, 99. So we must have done the 25th, maybe the 25th anniversary.
25 years old. Yeah. All right, Susie Q.
Okay. Well, I was trying to think of a summer album, and like, there were three bands and sounds that kept going through my brain. And one was Kim Mitchell.
I knew you were going to say Kim Mitchell.
Kim Mitchell.
Right?
I mean, okay. I had another one in my head. So, okay, Kim Mitchell. I lost that one. I didn't have Kim Mitchell in my head.
Okay. The other one was Robert Plant.
Oh, of course.
Been playing, like, you know, it just keeps going through my brain. And then the other
Sugar
one.
Ray.
Sugar Ray. No, but even though
Sugar Ray
had his time and place.
Yes, yeah. He did.
But no, the one that I thought about, like if I actually still had a commute or if I actually had somewhere fun to go in my car, that I would maybe roll down my window and
the place fun to go. It's called away from home.
anywhere to Tops. Would be
just for those watching. Tops is our grocery store, just in case you're one.
Tops never stops. I went with Dave Matthews Band, and the year was 96 and the album was Crash. It's really hard because honestly I think he makes a lot of good, and I know people like either love him or hate him or love the sound or
unknown color,
hang on, or hate the sound. It's hard to.
Is okay. That Dave Matthews calling you?
It
saying
was.
You picked the wrong album?
It's Sugar Ray, they're pissed.
I'll call you back shortly. but no, so for me, it's just relaxing, it's fun. For me, his sound is kind of like a dessert wine or something that's just easy, relaxing, not complicated. But again, you either have a taste for it or you don't. So I do, and I'm stuck like the other monkeys here. I am a humble monkey sitting up in here again. And that's why I picked this one. And of course, it's got the songs Crash Into Me, So Much to Say, Two Step. Too Much, Drive In, Drive Out, Proudest Monkey, Chicken Billy. I quick looked up because Deb was talking about awards and that, and I really wasn't sure, but this was, he did win for So Much to Say, or the band did, for Best Rock Vocal, and I think it was nominated for a bunch of other songs off this album. So, yeah, I mean, I want to say one of our daughters just said that they couldn't stand Dave Matthews Band. The sound annoyed them for some reason. But I think I listened to this album like every day for a year in the car back in the day.
Yeah, it was a good album.
Yeah.
I went to see them for the first time last summer, and one of the encores, it's interesting that you said Robert Plant, but they did a compilation of Jimi Hendrix Watchtower and Led Zeppelin The Rain Song. Okay. And it was unbelievable. Like the whole crowd was just, and I was never like Dave Matthews. Of course, he's talented. I like him. I'm not one of those, you know, groupies that follows him all over the country, but right. He puts on a good show. And I saw him twice within 6 weeks.
Yeah.
And both shows were completely different. That's how big his catalog is. So that's kind of cool too. It's always a surprise what you're going to get.
Yeah. My only thing with him, the band, I always wish. Sometimes I felt like they stuck too much to the original sound, and I wish they would have kind of just let loose a little bit more and made some kind of jazzier, just like, mm-hmm. you know, let's go wild, change the sound up a little bit. But maybe they do, and like you're saying, I mean, I haven't seen them that often, so maybe he does do that in concert and changes things way up. But anyway, I think it's a good summer album.
Yep.
And if you haven't listened to it ever, then you should crash. Don't crash your car. But yeah,
nice choice. It.
I bought that record in Dover, at a record store in Dover, Delaware.
Oh my God, you even remember?
And I listened to hell. I was at an Eagle Metal Masters.
I was on the planet Mars, and I thought.
You get a jazz. Paige Hamilton, the singer and lead guitarist of Helmet, actually started out in college learning jazz guitar.
That's cool.
Yeah, well, jazz is element that reaches everything. It's in all the albums mentioned here and there. You know, all of it has that element. I that album, if we were going to do a Dave Matthews ranking, it would probably fall one short of number one for me.
What would be your?
We can't tell now
because he always tours in the summer, so that definitely makes him a summer type of, you know,
artist.
It just felt right. Sorry, Kim Mitchell. Sorry, Robert Plant.
That's okay.
You're gonna call Sugar Ray back?
No.
Eating some lemonade and brownies, listening to that band. I can't remember all the stupid analogies I was gonna have now. Just scratch that off their show.
Sounded good.
Lantern reference that I forgot. I don't know.
What, Mark McGrath? No.
Mark,
that's right. His name?
It is?
Right?
Is it Mark McGrath?
Yeah, Mark McGrath. Yeah. Something like that. Yeah.
It's something very ordinary.
Yes. That's why Sugar Ray was the name, right?
Yeah.
The singer-songwriter. So many important ones. So many deep thinkers. You got visualizers who tell each, you know, you get a visual picture. And of course, the hook, the catchy ones, right? But what about those that just, well, they just make it lovely. Wonderful, tempered, atmospheric, folk, acoustic, or otherwise. Do you love that meal music you can put on and just feel impressed by the tone, the simplicity, the way a good vocal can reach in a whisper and a crack? Well, in 2006, an actor gave it a try, but he gave it more than an honest effort. It was just something that kind of blew me away at the time. I really didn't know he was an actor by trade, at least at this beginning. He is definitely more well-known as a singer-songwriter than he is as an actor. I'm pretty sure he's only got like three acting things to his trade at that point. But he's pretty good friends with Zach Braff, so of Scrubs. And of course, I'm talking about Joshua Radin. And the album, what is it called? They're Here Now? Oh my gosh. Now I don't remember the name of the album. We Were Here, which was the debut. And that was back in 2006. As you drift from the bed, I hand you a robe and so it goes. The moment passes. You're so long to get out the car. The way you read me, no one can see me. It's who you are. He had Chris Holmes produce this. Chris Holmes played guitar, bass, keyboards. He's a DJ by trade, multi-instrumentalist. He's worked with the Smashing Pumpkins, Daft Punk, the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, Rachel Yamagata, LCD Sound System, Mandy Moore, Interpol for Mr. Young there, Peaches, Sean Diddy Combs, The Chemical Brothers, Hot Chip, and of course, when you got all that in there, you had to have done something with Beck. So Chris Holmes, who's got all these, that not a single one of those people is like, oh, Block Party and Prince. Did I forget those? They might be important. I don't know. They're all big music things. Mandy Moore, a little soft key, maybe Rachel Yamagata, just keyboard. But if you listen to this record, it's so slight. It's so just acoustic guitar and his vocal, and then maybe a hint of piano from Priscilla Ann, AHN, if you want to look her up. She has her own music career as well. She's a pretty talented artist. Her voice against his in this, again, whispers, that's all they are, and the way it's delivered is absolutely gorgeous. My hands shake, my knees quake. It's every day, the same way.
Cause then came you, then there's you. I keep your picture in my worn blue shoes.
Chad Fisher plays some piano too. He's been in the industry a long time. The connection there is you're not going to hear this on radio. You're not going to experience it anywhere else but me talking about it right here. This is a forgotten album from 2006. If it charted, it was probably on like a hot list, and it probably made it in the top 50, you know, in there, close to it. There's no UK. This wasn't big in Canada. This wasn't big in Australia. You know, that it's Joshua Radin, and it's We Were Here. And, it's, well, I'm going to show it to you anyway. Duh, keep forgetting that part of it. But it was Sony, BMG. He has, if you like this, he has a plethora of albums. He's still in the music business, still doing his own thing. There's obviously an audience that knows, but for those of you that don't, that have been are tired of, you know, don't get me wrong, I could have done four albums today that were metal, hard rock. I had one that was a stoner rock record. I had a wicked jazz record. Wicked, I said I wanted jazz to bring something that was subtle and microscopic in the way it's delivered. I think I utilized not this record, but another record in an event with Deb, where it was played during dinner hour. Wax Paper, maybe, was the name of the record. It's just something you put on during dinner and still not feel like you've heard the same thing over and over again, but you're getting some vocal and a real warm feeling from it.
If you put on Helmet during dinner, it turns into a food fight.
Yes. Helmet at dinner.
That sounds fun.
Not gonna end well. Isn't one of the songs? All right. Well, join us in 2 weeks for more of this. I'll thank the panel for coming up with their albums. I'm hoping that it's something that the rest of our audience will take a listen into and give your feedback. Tell us, you know, like, Mark, really? I just heard an album for 40 minutes that they just whispered and they sang subtly. What are you, an idiot? Yes, more. Yeah, crazy. I love it. I don't know. Maybe you will too. We're on the web at beyondyourradio.com, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, articles, videos, and podcasts, all about music, bands, and artists, whatever I can get my hands on. Go Beyond Your Radio with us, a real music appreciation channel. Until tomorrow's album for today, happy listening.
Bye.